It's time to babble the fuck on. Live from the John Lovitz Podcast Theater, it's Hollywood Babylon. With your hosts, Kevin Smith and Ralph Garman.
It is Saturday night in Hollywood, so let's babble the fuck on. I'm Kevin Smith.
I'm Ralph Garman. Look at all you people braving Carmageddon just to get here.
Explain for those playing at home, sir, what is Carmageddon? Other than a fucking awesome movie where Liv Tyler had cookies thrown on her tits.
No, that's Armageddon. You're thinking of Armageddon.
That was a dream movie for me, man. Beautiful girl, boobs, cookies.
Yeah. Carmageddon is a phenomenon here in Southern California. It's becoming a yearly occurrence, apparently.
Yeah.
Where they will shut down a giant fucking freeway and paralyze everyone. they've done it again this weekend, and it makes it hard to get around. But look at this, sold out house again here at the Lovitz. How about that?
You guys rock. Thank you.
From Carmageddon to Garmin Kevin.
Nice, man.
See what
you
I did there?
You weren't a little afraid of Carthulu?
No, I wasn't afraid of Carthulu.
Rising up? I thought that's what Carmageddon was all about,
start
man.
Start eating our hearts?
Totally. Yeah. On my way here, I saw Ben Affleck crying to Bruce Willis going, Harry, I love you!
This is the second night out for Kevin and I. We had a date night this week.
Yes! Tell him about this. Me and Ralph finally did it.
No. No.
And guess who was the bottom?
Stop it. Kevin and myself and our buddy Jason Mewes, the three of us went to see Batman Live this week at
yes.
the Staples Center. If you get a chance, check it out because we had a blast.
It was fantastic. I mean, again, go in understanding that primarily they're going after family audiences and shit. So you can't be like, why don't they paralyze Barbara Gordon? You know, but it is for an overview of the. It feels like a greatest hits album.
Yeah.
And the audience treated it that way too. It was fun, man, because like every time, like you know, the little circus kid would come in, and like first it would be the parents, and they're like, Dick Grayson, come over here, and the audience would be like, wah! We know who that is. He becomes Robin. Everything, dude, when he was just like, I call it the Batmobile. They're like, wah! Any one of those motherfuckers could have gotten their dick sucked so many times that night. Even Harley Quinn. She was the belle of the ball. Everyone loved that character.
Yeah, I was not for Catwoman. Catwoman was hot, I thought.
Really?
Yeah.
More so than Harley Quinn?
Yeah, yeah. Because Harley was, you know, in bed, she'd just be like, hey, Puddin'. I don't want to hear that when I'm boning somebody. But Catwoman, she's all slinky and bad, and she would do bad things to you. She'd be up for anything.
I gotta be honest with you, the mere mention of Puddin' in bed makes me hard.
Well, sure, for you. Catwoman would give up the rusty litter box, you know what I'm saying?
I think it's fair to just say the pussy.
That too, yeah. But. All
right, it was a good show, though. It's traveling across the country. It started in the UK last year. We talked about it on this show going way back,
yeah.
Showed pictures, and we'd be like, oh, God, I can't wait. It came, we went. Totally worth seeing, man. If you're on the fence, you're like, I don't know. It's definitely, bring a kid, you'll fucking absolutely love it.
If you don't bring a kid, you look like three weird old losers like we did. Everybody say, so where are your kids? Home.
Yeah.
Just the three of us.
Yeah, we did look a little bit weird. But to be fair, everyone, we were in a booth, everyone, they were all adults.
Yeah,
there wasn't a single kid in that room. All kids at heart, you should say.
That's right.
But it was fun. I enjoyed it, man. And it follows, spoilers, it's the story essentially of Robin, Dick Grayson becoming Robin.
Right.
And, you know, they change it up a little bit for the show. But the staging is fucking phenomenal.
That was the most important, impressive part, I think.
It's crazy. They take this, like, back curtain or a backdrop and turn it into, like, this giant video monitor that then acts as the stage and the backdrop. So first you're looking at the exterior of Haley's Circus, and it's this giant tent, and you could come out a little door in the middle and stuff, and if you want to go in the tent, then you move inside. It's almost like a three-dimensional space. Somebody said something about 3D glasses. I didn't see them or anything.
No, I didn't see that.
I think
either.
For some of the bat things or something. Some kids, I saw them out. But it was pretty impressive.
Were they like special needs kids, though, who just wear them all the time?
Yeah, I was like, I want one of those special bat helmets that kid has. Where's mine? They're like, I was like, oh, sorry.
No, he's on the short bus.
It was a great show, though, man. For the kid at heart, if you got a kid, if you remotely like Batman, go support it, because you don't want this kind of thing to stop. You want them to do another one and shit right. like that, maybe do other superheroes. It was kind of cool watching.
And unlike the Spider-Man musical, nobody died.
Exactly.
So I was very impressed by that. Okay, let's get to the segment of the show where we say hi to some people who came particularly long distances or are celebrating special occasions. Tonight, it's called The Shoutouts.
It's a shout-out with Kevin and Brown, so get your cock out. Yeah, get your cock out.
I believe that's your first cock fumble ever. Or is it just that long? That makes a noise when you slap it on the table.
It got away from me like a salmon. I just couldn't hold on to it. It kept going. Wow.
Too much lube.
I guess. Anyway, and this part.
Oh, yeah. Then Kevin.
Sorry, that fucking got so distressed.
Yeah. As always, if you're listening at home, you want to send in a shout-out, if you plan on being in the show, it's hbopodcast@aol.com if you want to send it in. And we get tons of these. Unfortunately, we can't get to everybody tonight. We apologize, but there are some people we want to say hi to, like Lucy and Michael Leavesley. Yes.
Thank God we saved one of our shout-outs for you, the most enthusiastic respondent ever. Yes.
Well, Michael actually explains in his email that they are British, and that's why they won't
diplomatic immunity.
Once again, wrong country. But stiff upper lip and all that, they're not very expressive, you know, he's just being very polite. Yes, we're here. Yes, present. Thank you very much.
I would have preferred a little more hello. Maybe sweep up the fucking chimney while you're at it. And
they're not in the road production of Oliver, so I guess they won't be talking that way.
More?
Dear Ralph and Kevin, myself and my girlfriend Lucy, maybe fiancé if all things went according to plan on our trip to see you guys.
Did
Ooh.
It?
Ooh.
Oh, okay.
It did? You said yes?
Could you imagine if he was like, it didn't happen? Well done, sir.
Lost the ring. I lost the ring.
I had second thoughts. Right on. Where'd you do it, man? Why Yosemite of all places?
Better than Vegas? You're right, sir. Vegas is where you go to get divorced, not where you go to get married.
Right on, man. Congrats. When did it happen? Like fairly recently? A couple days ago?
Sunday.
Sunday. Right.
Sunday. We've been engaged for a week now.
We can't.
Consider yourself at home. Consider yourself one of the family.
What are you guys doing in Yosemite? Looking for the Horcrux.
Engagicus.
Right on, man. Well done. Yosemite's beautiful. What a great place to do it.
They came from Vegas, where they were gambling, drinking, shooting guns, and being the best man at a friend's wedding.
Shooting
all at the same
guns.
Time.
I want to go to that wedding, man.
They are from Sheffield in England.
Is someone else here from Sheffield, or you're just like, big fan? Are you from Sheffield? Do you know them?
There.
He's like, oi, I fucked her. You don't know her. You're safe, dude, you're safe.
Michael says, Sheffield's known for Sean Bean, the actor, the Arctic Monkeys, and the Full Monty, and not much else, he says. Mm. It's a steel city, right? Steel city? Could I please request a shout out for my girlfriend, Lucy, telling her how much I love her, and I hope to make her happy if she's accepted my proposal. If not, then fuck you, bitch. If you kindly do it in the vocal stylings of Ed Wynn, I would be forever grateful. Michael Leavesley, you'll never pronounce it properly, he added. How do you pronounce your last name?
Leavesley.
Fuck, I would have said that.
No. See, I thought it was Leavesley, but then he said, you'll never pronounce it properly. I was thinking, oh, it must not sound like it's spelled. It's got to be some tricky British thing.
Mind trick.
He fucked me.
Yeah.
Edwin telling Lucy that he loves her very much. Oh, my goodness, Lucy. Congratulations. You got engaged in a state park, don't you know? How romantic. Amongst the rocks and the dirt and the vermin. He loves you very much, Lucy. He loves you, and now you can spend the rest of your life making him miserable. Congratulations. Life is for the living, don't you know?
Well done. And by the way, welcome to America and welcome to Los Angeles, as we say here in L.A. Welcome to L.A. Put a dick in your mouth.
That's right.
Greeting doesn't work when they just got engaged. No. Well, it does for you. He's like, get to work.
You probably did that in Yosemite.
Yeah. Wait, wasn't there like a hantavirus scare in Yosemite?
Oh, that's right.
Did they tell you that when you came in?
They warned you about the hantavirus?
Yeah. They told you? They're like, you might get some hantavirus.
Have you been tested, or are you carrying it to the Lovitz here tonight?
Yeah, really.
Can we check them for mouse poop when you get a chance? That's how you get it, you know.
It's the mouse shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had to stop eating it for a while.
You get the imported stuff, you're fine.
Yeah, it's all clean from France.
That Russian stuff's the best. How about Daniel Tiberio? Hey!
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 Hot, hot, hot.
Shalom! Daniel is from Brazil. Brazil, I guess, as they say. I'll be attending the September 29th show. Basically, that's all. I don't ever remember you guys giving a shout out to someone to Brazil from Brazil before.
I don't think so, we have. No.
I would like to hear Kevin say hello to Brazil as Jason Mewes. Do you do a Mewes?
Kinda, I guess, sometimes.
You don't amuse me?
I've never done it before. I do it to him sometimes. Hey, welcome, Brazil.
Nooch. There you go.
It's not very good. It's just the one
Thanks
I make
for
fun
coming
of
out.
But welcome, man. Diplomatic fucking immunity to you.
We have fellow podcasters in the crowd tonight. Apparently, there's some folks who do a podcast called Monkey in the Cage. Are you guys here? Front row.
Stop.
Don't do my bit, sir. I don't come to your podcast and do whatever the fuck you do.
To be fair, you wanted to once, and I had to stop.
That's right. They just recorded their 50th episode. They're celebrating here. Karen Gonzalez writes us. She's the only female host who is literally surrounded by dicks most of the time.
Where is she?
Karen? Where's Karen?
She couldn't make it tonight.
She couldn't make it?
No.
Oh. There's the rest of them are still here, man. Just because fucking John Lennon's gone, you got to love the rest of the Beatles.
I don't go see Ringo's show either, man, you know?
Welcome, fellow podcasters.
Welcome, fellow. Congratulations on the 50 episodes.
Sorry for the death of your co-host.
Yes.
So weird.
Ghost podcaster.
Ghost podcast. What? Where? Boo.
Speaking of episode numbers, they just did 50. Tonight, 99. Our 99th episode.
Yes.
For you, that's a special number.
Yeah.
I would think you would celebrate that as much as the 100.
You name anniversaries, of course, like, you know, was it 50th is the diamond or fucking 10th is gold, one year is paper. Did you never hear that?
I don't think 10th is gold.
What is it?
I think it's...
Platinum?
Semen.
Semen.
The semen anniversary.
Hey, that's every year. Sadly, once a year. But just like that, man, it was kind of a naming it. This one we would call the Gretzky.
The Gretzky,
it's number
99, of course.
Yes. But also, you could like take it back to Prince for 1999.
Yeah, but I wouldn't. I wouldn't do that.
No, don't ever. This is our Gretzky episode, right?
And then
here,
next
man.
Week, the 100th, we're doing in Reno, Nevada.
Yeah, if anybody wants to make the trip, you should, because it's going to be a very special episode. We're going to do the exact same thing for the 100th time. But this time in Reno, so
that's
afterwards
right.
You can play some fucking penny slots, man.
It's very different.
Maybe wind up with a tranny hooker.
Again, same as every week, pretty much.
What happens in Reno winds up on our podcast, so come on out and see it.
Our Steve and Sue here. Husband and wife, Steve and Sue, where are you guys? What? Right there? Hello.
Hey.
Bringing my wife to the September 29th show with the Lovitz, being that she is an HBO virgin, can I have the voice of God, Charlton Heston, tell her what to expect?
Ah, oh my God, you can expect lots of jokes about anal sex and penises and Kevin touching penises and me having to pry penises out of his cold, dead hands. Ah. It's a madhouse.
Welcome, HBO.
Thanks
virgin.
For coming, guys.
Right about now, you're sitting here going, like, why did we leave the house?
Yes.
We should have finished watching the last season of Weeds.
Yesenia, are you here tonight?
How do you say it? How do you say it?
Yesenia.
Yesenia?
Yes, sir.
Yesenia.
Don't you have the hantavirus right now?
No, it's different. That's Yosemite. How would you say that? She put a pronunciation guide and everything for me. Yes.
Yes.
Nia. Yesenia, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Fuck you. Nah, you pronounced it wrong. What's the fucking pronunciation games tonight? What's that all about? Fuck the host? What's going on? It's Kevin's job.
And also, welcome.
Yeah. Yeah, that too. Yesenia is celebrating her 24th birthday tonight.
Oh, happy birthday.
But
that's the anal birthday, if I remember correctly.
It's a sad, sad story for her getting here.
No.
Yeah, I think we're going to need a little sad Hulk music, James, if you can hook me up. I was supposed to see you guys earlier this summer.
Casey Kasem.
After the guy I was dating with promised to take me. That week, I ended up in the hospital. Completely his fault, by the way. Oh, did he fuck you that well? Is that what happened?
What? That's where your head went
yeah,
with
think,
it?
I think he fucked her that
good. I thought maybe he like got in a car accident or something. Like, the only way you could put her in the hospital is by fucking her insanely good.
You're like so friction optimistic burns. In friction your, burns or something, you know?
You think that's what it was?
Yeah, or like she'd be like a twisted pelvis or something.
That hadn't occurred to me, but now that right, you mention it, it's horrifying. It.
What happened? How'd you get in the hospital? You don't want to talk about it. All right. Well, you know what? Then don't write fucking emails to podcasts if you don't want to talk about it. Jesus Christ. She writes, I went to the hospital. And then I ask her why she was in the hospital. Oh, I don't want to talk about it.
Now I know.
Oh, now it's a secret. Now it's a big fucking secret. Now I'm not telling anybody.
Now I know why we needed the sad Hulk music, because you're making everybody sad.
I'm about to Hulk out. I'm going to burst out of this shirt. You wouldn't like me when I'm angry, Kevin.
I know. I've seen it. Wait, seriously, what happened?
She won't tell us.
She might. Let me try. Stop being so hostile.
All right, I'll be over here.
Hey. How about I rub your back and you tell me what happened? I swear this will be about you. Really, though, what happened, man? Fuck. Something bad is
how's
what
it going?
I got
how's
after.
It going?
I got
how's
a little
it going
bit
so
more.
Far?
Just a little bit more, man. I think that's as deep as this is going to go. I'm fracking the fuck out of it, but ain't no gas coming, son.
Something bad happened. That's why one goes to the hospital. They crossed the streams. That's what happened. It was like Ghostbusters. What happens if we cross the streams? Something bad.
Yeah, yeah.
I struggled and talked to my doctor into releasing me early so I could make it to the show. But the day I was released...
Hey. Where's the music? Thank you.
I struggled and talked my doctor into releasing me early so I could make it to the show. But the day I was released from the hospital, the asshole uninvited me. He confessed to me that he'd been over me for quite a while, then told me he was trying to get into my friend's pants. And her friend's pants, too.
Ooh.
However, in light of recent events, I now think he's gay. So I've somewhat forgiven him since he's struggling with leaving the closet. Yep, well, that she'll volunteer. I bet she'll tell us all about him and the other guy.
Totally, there's all the information right there.
For my birthday, my best friend Abram was kind enough to bring me and make do on the promise the asshole broke. Could you please have David Bowie wish me a happy birthday, Yesenia?
Right on, man.
I think we shall.
Yeah.
Happy birthday to Yesenia. Happy birthday to Yesenia. Why were you in the hospital? Won't you tell us all, Yesenia? We want to know what happened. Why were you sent to the hospital? Happy birthday to Yesenia! Happy, happy 24th birthday. Happy birthday to Yesenia. Happy birthday to Yesenia. Happy birthday to Yesenia! I'm curious as to why you were hospitalized. Happy birthday, Yesenia.
Welcome and happy birthday. I got to add a few more moves to that. It's, I mean, I come and that's it. It rains, come, and I eat it. And yeah. Then I need a bigger closer than that.
A bigger closer than eating your own semen.
Yeah, yeah. It's not impressive anymore to me. Got to take it to the next level.
We also get sent emails from around the world.
Ain't no drag.
Garmin's got an email bag.
Featuring Kevin's reactions.
This comes from London, Ontario, Canada. Jen writes, Ralph, I was asking if you wish my best friend Andrew Clark a happy 30th birthday. He is the first of our group to turn 30, and I think he's entering it with a little trepidation. If you could wish Andrew a happy 30th as the McDonald's fry girl, I think he might enter his 30s with a big grin on his face. He's a great friend and deserves some politically incorrect humor on his birthday, his favorite kind. Jen from London, Ontario, Canada.
Happy birthday, Andrew! I love how you avert your eyes.
It's just like all I could see is the mouth of hell opening and you falling like Don Draper into it, you know?
All right. Happy birthday, Andrew. Would you like to celebrate with 30-piece McNuggets? That's like almost one McNugget for every birthday. We have many different sauces to choose from. Pesto, hot fudge, airplane model glue. Balsamic vinegar. I have to go check with my manager what the other ones are. Happy birthday!
Every time you do that, a little angel dies.
Well, too many goddamn angels anyway. This gentleman wrote us an email. He signed it simply Crappy Role Model. I guess he's a parent. Guys, the best way I can think of to get in touch with you, I work for a picture car company. You know what a picture car company is, Kevin?
A company that provides automobiles for movies.
That's correct. We worked on The Dark Knight Rises.
Ooh.
We have a legitimate Gotham City police car that the boss wants to sell. And knowing you guys are huge fans, I thought I would send you pics and a chance to buy it.
Get out of here. Let's see.
You want to see it? This is from Dark Knight Rises. It's an actual Gotham City GCPD police car.
I guess it was one of those left behind when the entire police force was underground.
Went underground, yeah. There were a lot of cars laying around after they all went underground. Came out a year later with no beards.
Fuck you, it could happen.
They brought razors with them underground.
Remember fucking that dude was giving them shit through the sewer. They were like, give us razors. We all look like shit down here.
One thing we need, a close shave. Now, I thought maybe you'd want to buy this.
Me, no.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh, you say so, sir.
But?
Let's flip around. Let's take a look at the back of the car and see what number car it is, shall we? That would be car number 99,
oh.
Sir. 99. Car number 99,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah, that is kind of sweet. What's the price, is he saying?
He does not say.
Oh, fuck that, then.
Come on. You're a big rich Hollywood type guy.
No, I'm not.
You got all kinds of coin to throw around.
The only way you stay a rich Hollywood guy is not by buying other people's shit. That looks cool, though, man.
I'll put you in touch if you're interested.
I don't want. No, I'm not. But I wish him luck. But that would be, I think, if you own a cop car, I think the cops look at you fucking.
I bet you can't drive it too easily around Burbank.
Fuck no, man. Yeah. Could you imagine? I'm like, look at me.
What the fuck, sir? It's a picture car. It's right. It's from a movie. Get the fuck out of the car, sir.
I'm from Gotham City, and I've lost my way. Who is your superhero?
I'm going to have to give you a cavity search, sir.
You're in Hollywood, sir. Our superhero is Liam Neeson. What's his superpower? Well.
The cavity search will be very painful. For you.
For you.
Greetings from Scotland, writes Dale from Scotland. He's got a bone to pick with me. Good thing he's not here, because I'm in no mood for anybody's shit tonight. I think we all know that.
You are. You're a little testy tonight.
I'm a little testy.
What happened, man?
Just a little ramped up, that's all.
Is that it? Yeah. Well, loosen up. Get him another drink, would you?
I think I'm sober. That's the problem.
Get him a lot of drinks, would you?
But listening to HBO from episode one, and it only seems to get better with time. Well, that's just patently false, sir. My only issue over these almost 100 episodes is porn star Kim Kardashian. I think it's high time you stopped insulting the good name of actual, genuine, hardworking porn stars by referring to Kim Kardashian as a porn star. Kim Kardashian has only done one porno, as far as I know, and it isn't even any good. Compare that with real, genuine porn stars who actually have discernible talents, like sucking cock. I mean, I flew a plane once, yet I don't go around calling myself a pilot. Nor do I believe I deserve the title, sir. And so I firmly believe that Kim Kardashian does not even remotely deserve to be called a porn star. If Kim Kardashian was actually a porn star, that would mean she was actually good at something. But as we all know, she is fucking clown shoes.
The ultimate insult.
My new favorite insult.
Yeah.
You are clown shoes. Stop tainting the good name of real porn stars. He said taint. Garmy Strong, Dale from Scotland. All right, I'll put that under advisement, sir. The only thing is I hate to give Kardashian any sort of publicity without saying exactly what she's famous for, which, as we know...
Maybe he's right. Calling her porn star Kim Kardashian is a little too much. Just call her fuck tapes Kim Kardashian.
I like that. That's even better. Chris writes... The current election had me looking for past experiences, so I watched PBS's American Experience and their episode on Richard Nixon on Netflix today. About 10 minutes in, it shows a page from his yearbook. I just about did a spit take. If you go to 5 minutes and 20 seconds in, you'll see what I'm talking about. Ralph, huge fan of the podcast, couldn't wait to share this with you. I went and found the tape that Chris was talking about. I brought it in. Here's a little piece of the life story of Richard Nixon. I think this deals with his high school years. He went to Whittier Higher in Southern California.
Yeah,
That's where he went to school. He talks about his high school election that he lost in. And you might want to keep a close eye on who won the vice presidency in that year's class election.
Nixon worked hard for everything he got. And his sober, industrious air sometimes put off his contemporaries. When he ran for class president at Whittier High, he lost. To a candidate he
holy shit!
And personality boy. He would not lose another election.
Do we have a still store of that frame that I was referencing there about the election? Look who won vice president at Old Whittier High.
Man.
Ralph fucking Garman. That's all I gotta tell you. That's not a common name either.
That's why you're so testy. You're like, in another timeline, I'm a god.
I crushed Nixon in that election at Whittier High. Go Cardinals, indeed. I'm guessing that's their mascot.
Yeah, it's got to be.
Isn't that weird? His name just shows up in history? I mean, Ralph Garman is an odd name. I've never met another one other than my dad.
I wish you had been watching it, and I wish you were shit-faced when it happened. That would so fuck with your
world. Imagine if I was on mushrooms or stoned or something, I saw that, I would leap off a building.
I'd be Dick.
I'm traveling through time. I'm a looper.
You see it?
Oh, did I fucking see Looper?
Is it good?
It's really good.
Is it? I like that dude. He did Brick, the guy that directed it.
Rian Johnson.
But, you know, obviously there's a dude in the movie that I've had some history with.
You do have a little history with one of the leads.
Is he that?
And it's not Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
No, it's the other dude. Is he that? Is he good? Is it the movie good and is he good?
The movie is good, and I hate to break this to you, but Bruce Willis is really good at it.
No, I don't. When he tries, he can be really fucking good.
Like on Cop Out when he tried on Cop Out.
Yeah, tried something there. What was it though? What is the movie about?
Oh, we don't have that kind of time.
Is it
good? It's time travel, which always is sort of, you know, complex.
Right.
But the basic premise is in the future, the far future, time travel exists, but they outlaw it because people are doing fucked up shit with it. So only the mob has a couple of these time machines. And in order to whack people that they don't like instead of killing them, which apparently is very hard in the far future because the cops are just that good, they send them into the past and they have them killed by assassins who live in the past and the bodies disposed of in the past so that there's no evidence of the murders in the future, which is their present.
That is the coolest fucking thing I've ever heard.
But the assassins they have waiting for them in the past
yes.
are like young street toughs who don't have much of a future. They hire them to be the assassins. They pay them well. These guys have a better life than they ever would have normally. But there's a hink to the deal. There's a little catch. When they're done with you, they send your old self back in time, and you got to off yourself.
So
they
the
call
young,
that closing your loop.
The young version of you
has to kill the old version of you when they send him back.
And both are okay with this?
Well, it's not ideal, don't get me wrong. But like I said, these guys think they have nothing going on in their lives. So if they're guaranteed another 30, 40 years, that's a good deal for them.
Right.
So they sign up knowing that that day may someday come. But you know, sometimes when you're young and stupid, you say, I'll deal with that when it happens. And then when you're staring yourself in the face, it's fucked up.
That's badass, man. I want to go now. When did you see it?
I saw it earlier. I saw it 2 weeks from now. And then I came back, and now I'm telling you about it. You're too stoned for that, aren't you?
I tried to process it. I was like, does he realize what he's saying? And then I was like, did he do what he said? Yeah.
Yeah, check it out. It's really good. Really
I want to see it now. It sounds like a movie I could take my lady to, man. Like
there's a five-year-old kid in it that gives one of the best performances of the year.
Does he play Bruce Willis as well?
No, there's only two Bruce Willises. Okay. His name is Pierce Gagnon. Remember that name because you will be blown away by this kid. He plays Emily Blunt's son, and it's just a remarkable
She's in it too?
Emily Blunt, yeah.
I like her.
Yeah, of course, her name's Blunt. You want to roll her up and smoke her.
Hadn't thought about that, but you're right, man. Bonus.
This next email comes from Richard in Seattle. In a world where any name or item can be essentially used as a euphemism for a sex act, what would a Ralph Garman be and what would a Kevin Smith be? If someone were to do a Kevin Smith, what would that sex act be? Say, oh, I gave her the old Kevin Smith last night.
Ass eating.
That's relatively simple. Why wouldn't they just say, I ate her ass last night? Why would they use the Kevin Smith euphemism?
Maybe they're talking to their mother. Duh. What would a Ralph Garman be?
I thought long and hard about this.
Like this. What would it be?
It would be me coming back from the past. And I blow myself. That would be a Ralph Garman.
That's a Ralph Garman?
No. I would like to have a woman sitting on my face, and I am enjoying the fruits of her...
You're eating pussy.
Yeah. All right.
What are you fucking doing the show at a kindergarten class or something?
I was trying to be a little more, you know...
romantic about it. I got a woman sitting on my face. And the essence of love is there.
Not Dangerfield.
Yeah, so I got a woman sitting on my face. I'll tell you, it's rough. Yeah. No respect.
So she's sitting on your face,
right.
Eating pussy.
And I'm on the bottom and she's on top because she's sitting on my face.
Yeah.
But she takes a bottle of Jack, and she pours it on her chest down between her breasts, and it just, like a river of Jack goes down her body and enters my mouth as I'm servicing her orally. So I get the best of both flavors combined. It's like a Reese's peanut butter cup, but for a grown-up. It's Jack Daniels and sweet, sweet vagina.
You got your pussy in my Jack.
You got your Jack in my pussy. Two great tastes that taste great together.
I thought a Ralph Garman would be you're being given head, and one of your enormous balls concusses a woman.
That's a burden I have to carry, sir. I wish you wouldn't make fun of it.
Literally,
two burdens
like.
I have to carry. And lastly, speaking of sex acts, Rick from Sydney, Australia writes, in Australia, we love to eat the chocolate wagon wheel.
Oh, all right, man. Fucking well done.
He sent us a photo. Apparently, there's a snack cake in Australia known as the chocolate wagon wheel. Yes, as the slogan says, you've got to grin to get it in. You think anybody pulled the guy aside who's selling those?
What? People do that? Crikey.
All right, we don't need any of that, sir. Thank you so much. It's the noise it makes when you bite into the chocolate wagon wheel. This last email leads us to one of our new favorite, well, that's not new, we've been doing it for a while now, but classic. One of our favorite segments of the show. It's where I try to creep Kevin out by doing a clown, putting on his white-faced makeup while singing the clown song. It's creepy clown time.
Creepy clown time?
Creepy clown time. Of course, just a quick reset. I started by doing this to Kevin as an actual clown, a hideous, maniacal, homicidal clown who was putting on white face makeup while slowly singing the clown song. And it creeped him out, so people started suggesting I do other voices to make it less creepy for Kevin. And we've done a bunch of them. We've done Bill Cosby, I guess, was one of the favorites. We've done Harrison Ford. We've done a bunch of the favorites. This email comes from Paul in New York City. Listening to an old HBO podcast, heard Ralph do a rare impression of Truman Capote. Yeah. Truman Capote, for those you don't know, was a famous author, wrote In Cold Blood, and then he became a big...
He was an actor, too. He was in Murder by Death.
And then he became a big name on the talk show circuit. He would always show up. He had a very distinctive voice. He became the pattern for the voice of Droopy Dog. Remember Droopy Dog, the cartoon?
Oh, my goodness.
Is that right? Is that where they got Droopy Dog
That's where they got
Truman
Capote,
for,
yeah.
I didn't know that.
So that's how Truman Capote talked. This gentleman thinks that would make a creepy clown. I think he's right. Let's find out.
That's more cute than anything else.
Not creeped out,
man.
Not creeped out at all.
That's not creepy at all. All
right.
You could do that to a small child as they went to sleep.
And Chris Hansen from Dateline NBC would show up. Every week we say goodbye to some people in show business who absolutely deserve a proper send-off. Tinseltown Stiffs.
And now another edition of
Tinseltown Stiffs.
They will be missed.
The first one probably won't be missed so much. His name is Johnny Lewis. He was an actor from Sons of Anarchy. He played Kip on that show, if you watch it all.
The Prospect.
Yeah. This is
Half Sack, the Half Prospect, sack, yeah. Yes.
This was a bad, bad scene. He was renting a room from an 81-year-old woman named Catherine Davis, and apparently he beat her to death, then climbed up on the roof of the same said house and either leapt off or fell off that roof and fell to his death. So there was a happy ending, at least.
Yeah.
Apparently, this woman, Catherine Davis, was sort of known as a patron saint of Hollywood. She would take in young, struggling actors all the time in this beautiful home in Los Feliz and put them up for...
She fostered artists. Yeah. That was her whole life. She came here from Texas in the 50s, and she's described... There's a beautiful piece, because this story has been going on for about 2-3 days or whatever. And whenever they talk about their 81-year-old woman was killed by this guy, he's named the fact that he was dating Katy Perry at one point.
Yeah.
Is always name checked. Nobody said the woman's name. Taylor Negron, the actor who's been in a zillion fucking things.
He's a stand-up as well.
But most people remember him as the pizza guy from Fast Times at Ridgemont High. I remember him as the guy from Punchline. He was the comic who was like, "You don't want carpet, you want an area." Very funny dude. He wrote this beautiful memorial to the woman, Catherine Davis, because he, like many actors, came through what they called the writer's villa. That's the house that she had. And he name-checked a bunch of people that had been there. Very famous people who'd like...
Val Kilmer, I think, lived there for a while. And
a bunch of cats.
Matt Bomer from White Collar and a bunch of other guys.
The article is so worth your read because he went out of his way to be like, look, everyone keeps referring to her as the dead old woman. He's going, what's really tragic about this is this guy killed not just a woman but a fucking saint.
Yeah.
Excellent piece. But in the piece, he wonders or kind of like, you know, I guess maybe... The way I read it is he perhaps knows a little bit more than some of us know because he was so familiar with the woman. They remained friends forever and stuff. Even when he moved out, he would go back there to have meals and stuff like that. But he, in the piece, kind of phrases it like, maybe this happened, maybe this happened. And his kind of theory of the crime was this dude, it came out, was like had a really bad drug problem. He was on some sort of synthetic drug, allegedly. he killed her cat. And he, the guy, what Taylor Negron thinks happened is she found it, discovered it, started screaming. She was struck by a 2x4. Then he destroyed everything in the house, including all the mirrors, and jumped and climbed up onto the roof because he thought he could fly.
Right.
Jumped off and landed on his fucking head. So he had some really bad drug issues, apparently.
He was fresh out of jail, apparently, and the cops say they believe he was on PCP or meth or a synthetic drug that the street calls Smiles.
Ugh.
Which is just creepy. Sounds like the Joker's in town.
Yeah, really.
So he won't be this
so
much.
So sad, but she man. Will. Read that piece, though, that Taylor Negron wrote. It's over on, site called exojane.com. Really wonderful tribute to somebody who was just the old woman in every fucking piece of the media. Like, everybody had more than enough time to be like, the killer dated Katy Perry, who you all know.
Yeah.
But nobody identified Catherine
Davis
until I saw the Taylor Negron piece, and then other people started name-checking her and stuff like that.
It's good that he put a face to the victim.
Absolutely. And the fact that somebody went out of their way to be like, without this person, like so many artists that you like, actors, comedians, writers, fucking, they wouldn't, it might not have made it to where they made it. This woman's house was like the first stop for people who were struggling, and she was one of these people who was like, you could do it. In his piece, he wrote that she was an artist up until the moment she died. Even at 83, she was putting together this book about the life of, I forget who it was, but she was on chapter 6 of the book. At 83 years old, she was still living the art life, and this fucking animal took some drugs and fucking ended it all. It's a really, really tragic story, but read Taylor Negron's piece because he does memorialize her very, very well. She deserved much better than the ending she got.
Absolutely.
She will be missed. I didn't know her until I read that piece, but my heart goes out to anyone who fosters fucking talent. This is a hard town, as most people know, and a lot of people come here going like, I can't wait to be in movies, and then fucking leave going like, I can't believe how much cum I've eaten.
Oh, you know? Stop it.
It's true. It's fucking true. So when you meet somebody who's just like, you know, takes you under their wing, and not in a negative way or a Svengali way, like I want to use you to get to something else or fucking take the life out of you. This was a woman who was just like, here, man, live here, you know, inexpensively and shit, and work on your craft. And here's some other artists. And apparently they would have these get-togethers with interesting cats from outside the country, Japanese violinists and stuff like that. So it sounded like a wonderful community, man, that now has just been brought to a fucking screeching halt by some asshole.
Don't do drugs, kids. That's the moral of the story.
Yeah, except weed is really good.
Yeah.
Weed never makes you think that you're fucking gonna fly, man. Weed, if you smoke weed, be like, I'll never fly. You know, just it's perspective, man. All perspective.
Babylon 5 fans will be sad to hear that Michael O'Hare passed away this week. He played Commander Jeffrey Sinclair in the first season of Babylon 5, if you watched that show. No one here did.
He will be missed.
Another voiceover actor. You know I'm a big fan of voiceover actors. Michael Rye was his name, one of the legends in the business, had done a ton of stuff. He was one of those guys who was working in the heyday of radio, doing radio dramas, and kept working through animation and voiceovers and commercials all the way up until his death at 94 this week.
Oh, big bucket of win there, man. Yeah.
He was the voice of the Green Lantern on Super Friends.
Get out of here, really?
We just lost Aquaman. Now we're losing Green Lantern.
We're losing our childhood.
Super Friends are dying.
Yeah.
He was King Gregor on Gummy Bears, Disney's Gummy Bears. Anybody walk that?
Yeah. Oh.
He did a ton of stuff for Hanna-Barbera for Disney. He was one of their stock players. I brought a little piece of film from Super Friends if you want to see him as Green Lantern. Had one of the great superhero voices of all time. I used to watch him. He was the voice of the Lone Ranger in an old 60s cartoon that I used to love when I was a kid. And I whenever I do like a superhero voice, I always chattered mine after Michael Rye's version because he always sounded so much like a superhero to me. Here he is as the Green Lantern from Super Friends.
I think I've finally ditched that phony Green Lantern.
Guess again, green fool. Your time is up. I'm going to permanently encase you in your own green energy bubble.
My power ring doesn't work on anything yellow. This yellow reflective road sign may just save my skin. Bullseye! Now that I've taken care of this computerized counterfeit, I'd better get back to the research plant.
That's Green Lantern for you right there.
Bullseye. Man. Now that I've taken care of this computerized counterfeit, I better get back to the research lab.
Think about how old that guy is, 94. You'll never meet him now. He's passed and whatnot. But how influential that guy you'll never meet was in your life. You have a sense of morality, yes, from your parents and whatnot. But also, when we were kids watching cartoons, superhero cartoons particularly, that was the example. It's like, do the right thing, do the right thing. So this dude was the voice, like, when I was a kid, of, you know, unofficially, do the right thing, do the right thing.
Yeah.
Very influential. Sad to hear that he had to go.
And I would go to school doing that voice. I'd be like, yes, I'm here at school. And then they would beat the shit out of me. So fuck him. Made me talk like that.
I'm a hero.
I guess you're made of yellow, my only weakness.
Singer Andy Williams passed away this week at the age of 84. Many of you may not even know who Andy Williams is.
Come on, really?
He was a star of the 60s and 70s, not so much the 80s and 90s. In fact, he moved to Branson, Missouri, which is where old acts go to die, and opened up his own theater there, the Moon River Theater, because Andy Williams was a legendary singer, as I mentioned, from that era. Had 18 gold and 3 platinum albums. I mean, at one time, he was the real deal. Had a bunch of TV specials. But Moon River was probably his biggest hit from the movie Breakfast at Tiffany. You've probably heard his version. Here's a little taste.
Moon River, wider than a mile, I'm crossing you in style someday.
Oh, no, that's a classy song.
No, it's a beautiful song.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Get off his dick. yeah, he was, when I was a kid, he was kind of still a massive fucking name, but you'd see him on, like, kind of a Merv Griffin type
show. He had a variety show for years that was very successful, and then he did Christmas specials for years and years and years, well into the late 70s.
I think, if I remember correctly, is he the father-in-law of Jason Bateman? I think Jason Bateman married his daughter.
Really?
Or was it Paul Anka's daughter?
Paul Anka,
sorry. Yeah. So somewhere Jason Bateman's like, hey, buddy, keep up with my marriages. I've got one.
He introduced the world to the Osmonds on his TV specials. We won't hold that against him, however, because he passed away. His Christmas specials were famous, were always getting big ratings. He also had one of the most successful Christmas songs of all time, was one of that he recorded. You may know this one.
It's the most wonderful time of the year.
Love
that song. Him?
That was him, yeah.
Wow, I never knew that.
The only problem I have with that song, and I tweeted about this earlier in the week, is a line there that says, there'll be sevens and stories and scary ghost stories. And I'm like, scary ghost stories? What kind of fucking Christmas did you grow up having, Andy Williams?
Maybe that's what he thinks about the story of baby Jesus.
And then the baby dies. But then it comes back to life. After 3 days, it moves a rock. It's in a cave.
Well, when you put it like that, yeah, it sounds a little
these
terrifying.
These scary ghost stories. I never cared for that. And lastly,
oh, this is a
this one hurt me. Herbert Lom was the name of an actor who played Inspector Clouseau's boss in all of the Pink Panther movies. Have you ever seen Peter Sellers as Inspector Clouseau? Chief Inspector Dreyfus was the name of the character, and he was in every movie that Peter Sellers made as in the Pink Panther films.
Even the ones he wasn't in.
That's true. He did the ones after Sellers died. He said it was always a nightmare working with Peter Sellers because they made each other laugh so hard they could never get through a take because they were constantly giggling.
That's an awesome job right there.
Here's a scene, a classic scene from The Return of the Pink Panther with Herbert Lom and Peter Sellers.
You didn't even arrest the old beggar.
There was some question as to whether the beggar or his Minky was breaking the law.
Minky?
What?
You said Minky.
That is correct, yes. Chimpanzee Minky. So I left them both off with a warning.
The beggar was the lookout man for the gang.
That is impossible.
Why?
He was blind. How can a blind man be a lookout?
How can an idiot be a policeman? Answer me that!
Yes, indeed. Chimpanzee Minky.
He was also in Dead Zone. He was the guy that Christopher Walken's doctor, and he has that wonderful scene where Christopher Walken's like, you know, if you knew you could stop Hitler, would you kill him? And then Herbert Lom does this wonderful monologue about blah, blah, blah. And at the end, he's like, but yes, I would kill the son of a bitch. Great, really great. Wonderful actor. 95?
95.
Huge bucket.
It's pretty
of
good
win.
Run.
Very good.
Every week we take a look at stuff that happens in TV and movies that really, with everyone involved in making one of these productions, someone should have said, well, that is shit that should not be.
And now for shit we should not see.
here's some shit that should not be.
This week's shit that should not be is from season one, episode one of the TV series Firefly. You guys, Joss Whedon's Firefly?
Bunch of fucking brown coats in the room,
yes.
Man.
Alan Tudyk's character in the very first episode, towards the end of the episode, is supposed to be flying the ship, supposed to be flying the Serenity. And for some reason, I guess it was technical or whatever, they couldn't actually put a steering wheel in his hand. And sadly, in the corner of the frame, when we zoomed into it in this clip, you can see that he is holding nothing. It's horribly embarrassing for everyone watching, and it must have been for him. Here's this week's shit that should not be.
There's no way they can come around in time to follow us now.
Just pretending to hold a steering wheel while he's flying a spaceship. Hey, look at me. I'm flying a Serenity.
He pulled it off, though, man. I was convinced.
You saw that steering wheel,
yeah,
didn't you?
Yeah.
And this week's exquisite acting.
To be or not to be, that is the question.
Welcome to the world of exquisite acting with Ralph Garman and Kevin Smith.
Exquisite acting is usually a segment where we take a look at somebody famous really overacting and doing perhaps too much on the screen. This week, it was suggested by so many people that we talk about this clip because it just apparently surfaced on the internet, including Kevin sent it to me and said, we have to talk about this. It's not anyone famous. It's from a little-known Turkish film from 1973 called Karateki Kis, which apparently in English means karate girl. And the lead girl in this film, apparently it's a revenge drama. She's going after the men who killed her father and her lover, and she guns them down.
Ew, were they the same thing?
No, not the same guy. Guns them down one by one, and this is known on the internet as the worst dying scene ever put on film. It's only a minute long. We're going to let it run in its entirety. Here's a scene from a 1973 Turkish film. It's the worst dying scene ever. Watch his hand that he's got the blood pack in as he reaches for his shirt and then squeezes. There we go. That's where the blood's coming from. You'd think that'd be enough to take him down. But wait, there's more. No, we're not done yet. He's a tough son of a bitch. One more for good measure. And there we go. She finally gets her revenge.
It sounds like...
Boy, is that... That could be shit that should not be, too.
They began his fucking, like... And then when it runs out of breath, they begin it.
Maybe that's why they call bad films turkeys. Maybe it's that film from Turkey
there?
That actually was the reason for that. But that's this week's exquisite acting, and it certainly is. Every week, we also invite you to send in your photographs of Kevin in inappropriate places. We've started photoshopping Kevin into places he just doesn't belong. It's a game we like to call Kev In.
What's Kev In today? Something crazy or awesome or gay? And by gay we mean homosexual, like maybe some dudes, but what's Kevin?
What's Kevin this week? Let's find out. This week's theme is Kev In Danger. This is Kevin photoshopped in scenes he just should not be in because it's very dangerous where he is. Let's take a look at the first one from Matt Osborne. It's from Raiders of the Lost Ark. Kevin should not be standing next to that dude who's wheeling that that scimitar.
Maybe he was aiming for me, man. That,
you could have caught a stray bullet. If Indy wasn't such a good shot, you could have been taken out.
Totally.
Many of you don't know that Kevin was also there podcasting the day Jack Ruby, Lee Harvey Oswald was moved from his prison cell after he assassinated President Jack Kennedy. There's Jack Ruby there who's killing Oswald, and here's Kevin podcasting over here. broadcasting live from the event. You could have been hurt.
I know.
I worry about you. You put yourself in these situations.
Sometimes you got to go there for the story, though, I guess.
And lastly, this is the most dangerous of all scenarios Kevin could have put himself in. Let's take a look at that. Driving the passenger side with Amanda Bynes. Taking a ride from Amanda Bynes. What were you thinking? You should know better.
Is that the Amanda Bynes song? That's
oh, we got one. We got one this week.
Is there really?
Yeah, we'll take a look at it as we look at the week's entertainment news with the HBO headlines.
Give me headlines.
Arnold Schwarzenegger's memoirs come out next week. His new autobiography called Total Recall. Oh, Arnold.
Which I understand they should rename Total Reball.
Because he talks about all his affairs in it. We only thought he had one. We thought he had sex with his housekeeper, and he impregnated her, but we should have known.
The number's rising.
Yeah, I like to have sex with a lot of women who aren't giant-chinned Kennedys. In this book, he talks about the fact that he had a torrid affair with Brigitte Nielsen, the actress who played Red Sonja in that film, Red Sonja.
He dipped his kindergarten cop in her Red Sonja?
Yes, he did. Of course, he was Conan. He appears in that film, doesn't he?
As Conan, Sonja? He has a bit part, yeah.
This was when he was already dating and living with Maria Shriver, by the way. He had the affair.
Where was Stallone in all this? Because wasn't he dating Brigitte Nielsen at one point?
I think they already were divorced. No, they couldn't have been. Because I think she was still married to him when he was making that movie. So they must have both been having an affair.
Could you imagine? She fucked two of the biggest box office stars of the 80s.
Yeah, but she paid for it.
How?
Because now she looks like Dolph Lundgren. So karma's a bitch. Life will come back and kick your ass. She was this statuesque beauty, and now she looks like a sock full of walnuts. And she was dating Flava Flav for a while. So
oh, my God, that's right.
It all comes back to bite you in the ass,
she's
people.
Gorgeous in Rocky IV, man, where she's like, the Soviet Union has entered professional boxing.
Yeah.
Very cute.
Yeah, she's hot. Not anymore. He also talks about having sex with the housekeeper. He did impregnate her. And apparently he's going to be interviewed tomorrow, Sunday, on 60 Minutes, talking about that affair. He says it was this, if I may, it was the stupidest thing I've done in the whole relationship. Really, Arnold, do you think impregnating someone else was stupid? I inflicted tremendous pain on Maria and unbelievable pain on the kids.
Yeah, man.
It was like the burn you get when you're doing those last reps. He also said when Maria moved out of the house after they separated, when she found out, when she was confirmed of her suspicions that he had the affair, she left the house. The children moved out. He was there by himself. He said he filled his schedule with speeches and projects and movie making because he was lonely. He said, we did everything together.
Him
talking
and,
about Maria.
And Maria.
Except apparently have sex with Brigitte Nielsen and the housekeeper.
Totally.
No, that I did by myself. And then that was stupid for me to do.
So, it's so weird, man. I guess I keep reading, like, he wants to get back with her, but that ain't the way to do it. By publishing a book on, I cheated on her before we were married.
Here's a list of other people I have fucked that aren't you. Maria, would you like to read the book? Lindsay Lohan's in the news this week as well.
Lindsay Lohan, why don't you come to your senses?
Oh, Lindsay, we held out such hope for you. This week she was hospitalized in New York City for what you can believe is A, asthma, B, a bad lung infection,
ooh,
or C, pneumonia, according to the sources that you talked to. Regardless of what she had, she was airtight. Her lungs were not working. She was hospitalized. They gave her some meds, and she felt much better because Lindsay always feels better after some medication.
This chick lives an adventurous life, man. She's like a fucking sitcom. Every week something's happening to her.
Yeah.
But it's
you
like
know,
Homer Simpson in real life.
You know who's nipping right at her heels? The new
Amanda,
pretender
Amanda,
to
Amanda,
the crown,
yes.
Amanda Bynes. And we've been talking so much about Amanda that our good buddy Dan Lewisell, who did Anne Heche's Butthole
and did the
HBO headline and did all those themes, he has done an Amanda theme for us that we're going to debut this week.
She will pay her fines and drive between the lines. No, you'll never escape from Amanda Bynes.
guy's a genius, man.
She won't pay her fines or drive between the lines. You'll never escape from Amanda Bynes. It's like a horror movie theme from
That's
the 50s.
That's awesome.
It's awesome. Amanda did not appear in court this week in Los Angeles to enter her not guilty plea to two counts of hit and run. She had her lawyer do it for her because she has moved to New York City to become the creator of a fashion line.
That's what she told People magazine she was going to do.
That's right, and apparently she is doing it because Wednesday night she locked herself in a restroom in a cupcake shop for a half an hour. It wouldn't let anyone use the bathroom.
Maybe that's her fashion design office.
People were pounding on the door asking if she was all right at the Little Cupcake Bake Shop in the Soho neighborhood, and she would not answer them or wouldn't come out for a half an hour. I get pissed off when I'm at Starbucks and I gotta pee and I gotta wait 3 seconds for the bathroom door to open. Imagine if you really had to go at the cupcake shop.
What do you think she's doing in the bathroom?
She said when she came out she was putting on her makeup.
Yes, but what do you think she's really doing?
Heath Ledger didn't take that much time to put on his makeup for the Joker. I have no idea. I'm assuming she's getting high, right?
Or maybe she's just, like, lost. It seems like she spaces out and shit, like falls
she's
down
lost in the bathroom.
Yeah, I guess. I don't know, but
I'm thinking she got stoned. She went to the cupcake shop because she had the munchies. She ate a bunch of cupcakes. She evened off. She had to go back into the bathroom to get stoned again to eat more cupcakes.
Either that or she, like, fell asleep in the toilet, man, which is a distinct possibility.
She has got two more counts of driving with a suspended license and another count of driving under the influence that she has to appear for in court on the 29th, but they assume she won't be back.
Really? So what happens in that case?
You can send your lawyer. You don't have to appear in person. You can send your legal representative, at least for the early stages of trial sometimes, and they can plead for you.
If they convict you of something, can you send the lawyer to jail?
I don't believe so. I think you have to do your own time.
It's a shame. It sounded like a pretty cool system.
But apparently, Amanda likes to be in closed spaces for a long period of time, so she's going to do very well in jail. She locked herself in a dressing room for 2 hours. She locked herself in a bathroom for half an hour. She's going to like the snug comfort of a cell.
Three hots and a cot, man.
That's right. And let's go for the trifecta. We talked about Lindsay Lohan. We talked about Amanda Bynes. It's time to talk about porn star Kim Kardashian.
Kim Kardashian, Kim Kardashian, who gives a fuck?
I thought we agreed to call her Fuck Taped.
You were going to have to change that. Yeah. Fuck Tapes Kim Kardashian was told this week by her boyfriend Kanye West that he wants her to be the face of his new fashion line, but first he wants her to drop 20 pounds.
Fuck. How do we know that? Who told that story?
A source close to the family heard Kanye say it to Kim. First-hand account of that conversation being had.
If he told me to lose weight, I'd be like, how much? Because he's probably going to make a shit ton of money, man.
I think she does it. She'll do whatever he says.
Really?
Yeah.
But she isn't her
He wrote a song about her called Perfect Bitch, and she said, I'm so flattered. She'll put up with anything.
Why though? Why on earth would she even think about... Her whole shtick is... Look at my body, it's natural and shit like that, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Why would she even think about altering that just for... That would go against everything she kind of stands for, but she doesn't really...
Kneels for.
Yeah.
Maybe she's a little too natural these days. He'd like her to be a little less natural.
Yeah.
She's a little more curvy than usual this week.
Really?
Yeah, from the photos I saw.
So he's just like, drop some weight.
Yeah.
Oof.
He's already dressed her, so I guess he's going to start talking about how she works out and how she looks.
Jesus.
Conway, works. But Kanye Conway. Tim Conway is in the news. Kanye West
Tim
also.
Tim Conway's like, I think she should lose 20 pounds too.
Kanye West has his own problems. There are not one but two sex tapes now being shopped around to porn companies that they want to sell. Featuring Kanye West.
Fucking.
No, it's Kanye. The first one's Kanye fucking a girl who looks just like Kim Kardashian.
That was what we talked about last week.
Right, who's apparently 18 years old and married and was talking about how she was cheating on her husband with Kanye.
I remember that. Yeah, right? Terrifying.
In the second one, it's another young lady. This one runs for 40 minutes, they say, with no interruptions and no editing.
Not bad.
Yeah, not bad at all.
I
would
try
release
to play
that.
It off, but that's
I would release
good.
That too if I was him. I'd put it in everyone's home.
We have a 50-minute playlist for fuck music, and I only
15 minute?
50
minute.
And I get through this first song and a half. So
I think a 50-minute playlist for fucking in your house is very, very...
I'm trying. I'm reaching the peak, man. It's like, you know...
It's very ambitious.
Yeah, you got to aim high, I see.
And this is my favorite Kardashian story of the week. Kris Jenner called the iPhone, the Apple store this week, looking for the iPhone 5. Everybody wants that. She called him up and said, yeah, I'm Kris Kardashian, or Kim Kardashian, or Kris Jenner, Kim Kardashian's mom.
No.
Put five of them aside because all of my family wants to have one. And the Apple store said, no, we don't play that game.
You
have to come down if you want those.
Well and, done, Apple.
And she said, you don't understand. I'm Kris Jenner. I'm the momager of the Kardashians. And he said, I understand. Come down and get in line if you want a phone.
Right.
So she sent her assistant down there and asked for the manager. And the assistant said, I'm here on behalf of Kris Jenner and the Kardashians. I'd like to get five phones. And he said, security, please show her where the back of the line is.
Nice.
So good for Apple.
Because it's an emergency for them to have the fucking latest phone because, you know, they're on TV. It's very
exactly.
important, Ralph.
Here's the thing. They should take a lesson from Erin Moran about how quickly fame can fade. Erin Moran played Joni Cunningham on the most popular sitcom in the world, Happy Days. That's right. She was just 14.
She had her own sitcom at one point. Joni loves Chachi.
That's right. She was on top of the world. She is now 51 years old and was thrown out of the trailer that she was living in Indiana.
Oh.
Here's Erin when she was Joni. This is her Joni Loves Chachi days. Very cute. Here's Erin outside the Holiday Inn in Corydon, Indiana. She was living with her husband's mother in the trailer. The mother threw them both out because she was bringing home people from the bars and partying at the trailer.
Joni was?
Yeah.
She don't love Chachi anymore?
No. Apparently, Joni loves Hoochie.
Oh, that's a shame. I mean, look, everybody ages. You can't be like, oh, I can't believe she doesn't look like Joni anymore. But
you don't have to live in a trailer.
Yeah, there's a lot of road miles, man.
They just won a settlement over the Happy Days licensing. Remember that?
Yeah.
They were each given $65,000 as a payoff. So they said she's burning through that pretty quick.
Oof.
Yeah.
65K, that's it?
Yeah.
After all that time?
That doesn't buy you much Jägermeister and cartons of Kools. You know what I'm saying?
No.
Yeah. See the Emmys? Did you watch the Emmys Sunday night?
I did not.
Sofia Vergara and her friends over there at Modern Family won for Best Comedy this season, which I love that show. It's very, very funny. 20 minutes before she went on stage to accept the award with the rest of her cast, though, she had a wardrobe malfunction.
Oh.
She looks like she was packed very tightly into that dress, and it turns out she was. I was hoping when I heard this news that there would be boobs akimbo, which was my radio name back in the day when I was a DJ. But because she's got 32 Fs. Natural 32 Fs.
Boobs.
I
thought
no,
you were talking about
not...
her grades. I was like, why does that matter, Ralph?
She's not playing Battleship. You sunk my destroyer.
32 Fs?
Fs.
That's pretty big, right?
That's pretty big.
Yeah.
But that wasn't the problem on her dress. Can we see the photo of her her wardrobe malfunction? The zipper apparently broke in the back. So that's her butt that was hanging out before she had to get up on stage at the Emmys.
Oh, nice.
Yes, ass! Apparently they stitched her up and got her up on stage in time, so she was fine.
Yeah, and that's not a bad one at the end of the day.
No.
She could have like just walked out.
But that ass, I wouldn't wear any dress at all.
Yeah, I'd be like, keep ripping it, man.
Exactly.
Show them what I got.
We're assless chaps to the Emmys. next month is James Bond's 50th anniversary. They're celebrating with a brand new Bond movie called Skyfall.
Yep.
With
Daniel
Craig.
Craig is back.
They're also re-releasing the entire Bond series on Blu-ray in a box set. You can pick it up. Everyone is participating in selling the 50th anniversary of James Bond. Roger Moore, Sir Roger Moore, is on board. He's doing some personal appearances. Pierce Brosnan has agreed to help promote. The only person that won't help promote? Sean Connery. He says he is pissed off at the makers of Bond because he thinks he was cheated out of hundreds of thousands of dollars. And so he refuses to participate in celebrating the 50th anniversary of Bond.
I believe we have a statement from him, probably.
I don't like Jews. Where's my medication?
I think, actually, I mean, I don't want to... if I had to speculate, it's probably less about, like, they owe me money and more about he's had some health problems.
Yeah, that's what I've heard,
years.
Too. The Bond franchise, by the way, has made $1.6 billion in the United States alone. Not too shabby. Samuel L. Jackson made some news this week. He is a vociferous Obama supporter.
Mm-hmm.
He put together a video that was released this week. It's a sort of a takeoff on his children's book.
Go
to Fuck
to
Sleep. Remember that book that he read? Go the Fuck to Sleep with a children's book for adults, really, that he read the audiobook version of was very popular. He is has released a video this week about Obama and about the people who perhaps are a little lax in participating in this year's election. It's called Wake the Fuck Up. Here's a little taste of Sam Jackson's video.
Big brother, please. Obama sent SEALs to bin Laden's place. Romney sent jobs overseas. And how about that student loan overhaul? It's gonna save you thousands of bucks. Mitt will cut that shit in a second. My dude, wake the fuck up. Oh my.
There doesn't seem like there's any possible way Mitt Romney can win, is there?
I think absolutely.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't know. All the polls I see, it seems like Obama way ahead.
Yeah, but it depends, I think, and I'm not a political science major, so correct me if I'm wrong, but this whole voter identification, this registration thing that they're trying to push
through.
Did you
see the Sarah Silverman short about it?
Yeah, it's scary stuff.
A short online that is really educational, funny as fuck as well, but it's a satirical look at the voter registration process and who it eliminates.
Yeah.
And it's kind of scary, very scary.
If you don't have a government-issued ID, you may not be able to vote, so that might be a problem.
It's very strict. So you think, like, that's...
It's going to have an effect, sure.
Really?
Yeah.
I just think he comes across, like, so wooden and stuff like that. I saw them release a picture this week, which, to me, reeked of desperation. There was a photo taken of him when he was in France doing his Mormon mission, and he drew a giant heart in the sand, said, "I love Anne," inside of it, and he was standing by there, and there's a backstory to it. His friends helped him take this picture when he was courting his wife and stuff. If you're reaching so far fucking back to, like, when he was 19, he had love in his heart.
He was cool.
Yeah, I mean, that's a little fucking weird to me. I think they're desperately trying to humanize a guy who just seemed to me, and I'm not a political person, but it's all about fucking money, 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 money.
Yeah.
And we make money and keep the government out of this, and I don't know. It just didn't, to me, he didn't seem to have any of the fucking answers that were any different than anybody who came before him. The fact that his the Obamacare medical program is really resembles what this dude did
in Massachusetts.
Massachusetts, yeah. You sit there going, "Well, aren't you guys on the same page?" I don't know, but I was just wondering if you thought he had a snowball's chance in hell. Apparently, you do.
I never count my votes before they're decided by the Supreme Court. Movies that will suck this week.
Them.
This week, some people talked about making some movies that we just know will suck.
Bruckheimer, Schumacher, Michael Bay, they make movies that make you say, "Oh my God, that's bullshit, what the fuck? They're movies that will suck."
This week it's been announced a major motion picture, a big budget major motion picture, is going to be based on the 1960s TV show Mr. Ed.
No!
For those of you who don't know what that is, that was the story of a man and his talking fucking horse. Listen, in 1963, that may have been entertainment. But if you show me a guy talking to a fucking horse in my movie theater, I will kick you in the balls. They say, "But no, now we have the technology. It'll really look like he's talking." Fuck you. It's still a guy talking to a horse. But it's good. His lips are gonna move. Fuck you. Sarah Jessica Parker will star as Mr. Ed.
Samantha, order another apple teeny.
They didn't drink apple teenies. They drank Cosmos.
Oh.
Silly.
Sorry, I didn't watch enough episodes of Sex and the City.
I watched them all. I like that show. I did very much. I thought it was good. I thought it was sassy writing, and they all cursed a lot, and they fucked. And it's a good show, man.
All the other girls agree with you, Kevin.
I'm with them, dude. I'll be over there getting laid with the women. Fuck you.
No, you won't. You'll be shoe shopping with the women.
It's fine.
In music news, Jaden Smith has released his newest rap song. For those of you who aren't familiar with the genius that is rapper Jaden Smith, he is the 14-year-old son of Will Smith. As I've mentioned before, he was born on third base and thinks he hit a triple. This week, he released a video for his new rap song, The Coolest, where he talks about how older women want to have sex with him because he's so rich. I hope he plays Mr. Ed in the movie so I can hate them all at once in one fell swoop. Here's the video of Jaden Smith rapping about how he's the coolest.
It's the coolest of the coolest, it's the smoothest of the smoothest, it's the crudest and the rudest of the stupid kids. Mr. Vicious with his missus blowing kisses to his mistress and his missus blowing riches like some hooligans. I wasn't tripping, I just listened to these women when they sipping on them juices. They say Jaden, yeah, he's too legit. And I be flipping cause they slipping and they dipping in the pool. They say I'm pooling, they be drooling cause I'm stupid rich. I might be tripping, but I'm living how I'm living. I'm 14, I'll be forgetting.
Stop it! Stop! Stop raising the roof. They be tripping because I'm super rich. Yeah, you've earned it too, you 14-year-old fuck. Hey, you know how you got super rich, Jaden?
No.
You were born to the right parents. Wouldn't that be nice if we all could earn our money that way?
This is the uncomfortable part of the show where Ralph fights with children.
I don't know. If you're putting yourself out there, if you're a rapper and a movie star and you're going to be out there, you have to take the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune just like everyone else.
Very true.
He is held accountable for the rhymes that he supposedly writes.
The crimes, if you will.
That's right. More music news. Pete Townsend of The Who, a guy who actually had some talent, who worked hard in his life.
He's here.
Has a new memoir out called Who Am I? See what he did there?
Yeah.
Geez, between Total Recall and Who Am I don't know which book to buy. They're all so fucking clever. If it was the Pete Townsend story, I would read it just as quickly as I would if you called it Who Am I?
All right.
He says he doesn't consider himself bisexual, but he did have sex with one man.
Oh.
That he admits to in the book. Mick Jagger.
Really?
Yeah, I'm sorry, sir, but the big Who fan just went, oh! He said Mick Jagger was the only man he ever wanted to have sex with, and he did. He also says that Keith Richards was lying when he wrote in his autobiography, Life, that Mick has a, in his words, tiny todger.
He's saying that.
Let me tell you what he said. Pete writes that Mick is huge and, wait for it, extremely tasty.
The fuck out of here!
And good night.
Oh my God, man. How old is he? He must be old to say that.
Pete is in his 60s.
You gotta be like at a point where you're like, I don't give it a fuck anymore. He was delicious.
Even if you're going to admit that in your book, do you have to add that?
Wow.
Does that
man.
Have to be the coda to the sentence?
Look at
yeah, he was. So he was fucking huge and fucking tasty. Look, I've had a lot of things in my mouth, okay? But Mick Jagger's cock is one of my favorite meals ever.
More music news. Lady Gaga's ass is being made into a handbag. I don't mean literally. They're not going to skin her like Buffalo Bill in Silence of the Lambs and make a handbag out of her ass. But her ass has been molded and will inspire a handbag made by an Italian designer that will sell Gaga ass bags.
I want one. I don't know else to say it.
Their
that sounds amazing to me.
Molded in the shape of Gaga's ass, and that will be the shape of the handbag that women will carry. It's debuting in the French Paris Fashion Week. They will be first ever available, the Gaga ass bags.
Please tell me they're going to do a fanny pack version.
I don't know. Have you seen Gaga lately? Can we throw up a picture of Gaga? They should make it a suitcase, really, I think. They should make some luggage out of it. She has gained 25 pounds, and people are talking about her severe weight gain.
She gained 25 pounds? I thought she was just born that way.
Oh.
Maybe I will. Maybe after the show when I'm crying, I will file it.
More music news. Carrie Underwood. I don't like country music so much. Are you applauding for me not liking country music or for Carrie Underwood? Yeah, okay. No, it's okay. It's all right. Carrie,
hey man, before you jump into Carrie Underwood, when we were at Batman Live, did you see Leanne Rimes was there?
No.
Leanne Rimes was at Batman Live as well.
Was her cut man there working on her eyes? I know she's a cut man like Rocky in the 10th round against Apollo Creed. How does she see anything? Hello, I'm Leanne Rimes.
I guess whoever brought her told her they were going to see Dark Knight Rises, and she was just like,
right.
Okay.
It's awful loud in here. Carrie Underwood was on tour in Kentucky, Louisville, Kentucky, and a 12-year-old boy was holding up a sign to the audience and said, "Can you be my first kiss?" How genius is this fucking kid?
It's a good scam. Really good scam.
Because you can only get away with that shit up to like 12.
Yeah, yeah.
At 13, it just gets fucking creepy.
But when God forbid you're fucking 42 holding up that sign.
Like you were at Batman Live, remember? Doing that to the Joker. 12-year-old Chase was in the audience with a sign saying, "Will you be my first kiss?" And so she brings him up on stage. Here's a little video of Carrie Underwood
video.
And 12-year-old Chase.
You yeah. Rock, dude.
But how are we gonna do this? Lip to lip.
That's sweet.
That is
man.
Sweet. No one had the guts to tell little Chase that it's all downhill from there for him. He lives in Kentucky. His next kiss is going to be his sister, so it just doesn't matter. Next, it's Honey Boo Boo for you, Chase. Please enjoy your one moment of kissing a hot country superstar.
I wish he would have just went for French kiss right at the last second. Just like, ah!
He should have went for the cunt in country, I think. That's what he should have gone for.
Oh, really? She's like, "How do you want it?" He's like, "Oh, right in your puss." Is that cool?
I'm going to give you a Ralph Garman. A bottle just fell out of someone's vagina. A Jack Daniels bottle. Kesha said she had sex with a ghost. Stories this week, I couldn't write them if I wanted to. Between Pete Townsend sucking off Mick Jagger and now Kesha fucking a ghost, the world's gone mad. She said she had sex with a ghost that caused her to write her new song, Supernatural. It's about the experiences with the supernatural, but in a sexy way. I had a couple of sexual experiences with the supernatural. I don't know his name. He was a ghost. I'm very open to it, she said.
Chid's a poltergeist penis.
It's so weird. Sometimes I like a little vagina. What? Where? Boo. She had sex with a ghost. Shut the fuck up, Kesha. You didn't.
Maybe it was Christmas time.
She got a scary ghost story? To celebrate all things geek, like Kevin and myself, we like to talk about the geek news.
Ralph and Kevin, Ralph and Kevin, Ralph and Kev. Geek news.
It's been announced that Mark Webb is returning to direct Spider-Man 2. We're getting another Spider-Man from him. The Amazing Spider-Man, the first one, made, I didn't know this, $751 million
yeah,
worldwide.
Yeah, cleaned up very well.
It was
well.
A big hit. There was some doubt as whether he was going to return or not because he had a deal. He had to give Fox another motion picture after 300 Days of Summer that he also directed.
Okay.
But he was able to get out of that contract. So they are going forward with Spidey 2. It'll be May 2nd, 2014.
Did they say who the villain is?
Kesha.
I'm a ghost fucker. I'm
I
fucking
fuck ghosts.
Ghost.
I'm so out there. I party so hard. I fuck ghosts. Brush my teeth at Jack Daniels. Fucking talentless cunt. More geek news.
So weird when women support that.
Well, they know how I mean it. I mean it in the most appropriate way.
I mean it in a sweet way.
That's right. Thor's Jamie Alexander was damaged, I was going to say, was injured. Damaged, like she's property. She was injured on the set of Thor the Dark World, the Thor sequel. Jamie Alexander plays Sif, Lady Sif of Asgard.
Yeah.
We got a shot of her here. This is from the first one. This is her. She
was good in the movie.
She was real good.
And in the comic, she fucks Thor.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I think that's how she got injured. Yeah. It was like, yes, Cena over there in the hospital, you know, it was just too good. I had to put her in.
I made her Thor.
She was on the set where she experienced what they're calling a horrible injury. They won't say what it was, but she tweeted, "I'm lucky not to be paralyzed."
Ooh.
Again, she fucked Thor. Chris Hemsworth's like,
"Verily, I knock the bottom out."
She is currently in the hospital. They say she's going to physical therapy, but
Jesus.
She says she's in recovery mode. Her spirits are high. I'll be back kicking ass as Lady Sif in no time. So I guess it was a pretty serious accident. She fell on the set. It must have been back-related, I'm guessing, but she's going to stop it. But apparently she's going to be fine. She will recover and will complete filming.
She'll be in the flick, though.
She'll be in the
good
flick,
good for her.
Yeah.
She was good in the last one, man.
More Marvel movie news. They, of course, are working on The Wolverine, the next Hugh Jackman Wolverine movie. The first photos have been released from the set of that film. It's taking place in Japan. He's encountering the Silver Samurai will be the villain.
Oh, they're going to do
that
storyline.
Yeah.
Wow.
Here is Hugh Jackman. And before we take a look at Hugh Jackman, let me remind you that Hugh Jackman is, I think, the same age as me.
Okay.
Let's take a look at Hugh Jackman.
Okay.
Fuck Hugh Jackman.
Yeah, man.
That's some bullshit right there.
You can't live up to that.
My wife is going to go see that because he looks like that. She hates fucking comic book movies. The only movie she ever wants to see is like, what's that Wolf movie that Hugh Jackman's in? Can we go see Wolf, Tangerine? The Tangerine Wolf? It's the only thing she gives a shit about. The only time she wants to go to comic book movies is when Hugh Jackman's in the movie. Now he's going to look like that. He's never looked better as the Wolverine than he does right now.
It's true. He actually looks better this time.
And then I'm going to come home and I'm going to get undressed. And she's going to throw up in her mouth. I don't need that from Hugh Jackman.
She's like, I wanted to fuck Wolverine. I'm fucking the Blob.
And lastly, in the geek news, are you guys familiar with this Gangnam Style?
Gangnam Style!
Gangnam Style is just taking over. Psy is his name. He's a Korean musician. And, yeah. He's just had this monster hit with this started as an internet sensation. Now it's on the charts. It's a monster hit, inspiring a ton of parodies, as you can imagine. None more so than this one that was sent to me from Daniel Evans in Shropshire in England, in the UK. It is a bunch of Star Trek geeks who literally have taken the lyrics of Gangnam Style and translated them into Klingon.
Oh.
I brought in a little taste for you. Here's Klingon Style.
Open Klingon style. Klingon style. Kapon Rotar, Ikusaka Blajita. You will not do chocolate cuckoo get me fat to mouth. You host talk naked for back. What not you could have my wish? Collect in as coplante. Could have bottles. What your poor my cup.
Worf is getting mad ass in that video.
Dr. Klingon style.
Before we say goodnight, folks, there's a musical question that we have to ask. And it's not Klingon style. It's a different song that we sing every week. It's about the size of a certain Irish actor's penis.
Oh, we can't help but wonder how big is Liam Neeson's cock?
How big is Liam Neeson's cock? Well, it's fucking big. Good night, everybody. No, every week we take a look at the top facts about Liam Neeson's cock that are sent to, of course, neesoncock.com.
This used to be my favorite part of the show, but now it's the saddest part of the show because it always means that we're coming to a close.
I know. We got to end eventually.
It's a bittersweet way to go out, though. We go out talking about dick, big, thick, veiny cock.
All right, easy. Easy, Pete Townsend.
Fucking
Mick
tasty,
Mick Jagger's cock
man.
Is so fucking tasty. They should... They should offer it on the menu at Subway.
How big is Liam Neeson's cock? Nope, you're wrong. You gotta wait for me to say, Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
There it is. How?
It's the reason the guy in the Scream screams. Can we put up that picture real quick? Yeah, that guy. He saw Liam and they painted him.
Yeah.
Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
Its gravitational pull destroyed the planet Krypton. Now we know why it all exploded.
Too soon. That was funny.
Along those geek lines, Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
When he orgasms, he opens a boom tube from Apocalypse.
Dark side.
All right, we'll leave the geeks behind. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
That if Hannibal Lecter can finish it in under an hour, he gets a free T-shirt and his picture put up on the Wall of Champions.
I'll take that challenge.
Need a lot of Chianti for that thing, man.
Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
The boogeyman checks under his bed for it before he goes to sleep. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
Gary Busey suffered brain damage after after crashing his motorcycle into it in the early 90s.
Wow. Wow, man. That's obscure.
That's my favorite one of the week. Oh, Jesus. Liam Neeson's cock is so big. It's the reason Apple introduced a panoramic camera on the iPhone 5. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
That after he has sex with you where the sun don't shine, the sun always shines there. When you're driving home tonight, you're going to laugh hard at that one. When you play it out in your mind. Liam Neeson's cock is so big. Men were so envious of its size, it was the official cause of the Great Depression. I didn't know that.
Psychological depression.
Yeah, exactly.
I see.
Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
Donald Trump competed to become its apprentice. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
He didn't lose his virginity, he had a maiden voyage. Must be the authors of that one back there. Or Titanic fans.
Totally.
Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
Pete Townsend said it's tastier than Mix. That's it for this week, folks. Thanks so much for coming out.
Ladies and gentlemen, did you have a good time this evening?
Thank you so much for being here. We can't do this without you. We really appreciate it.
Thanks for selling us out. We won't be back here until, I think, October 27th.
Yeah.
Because I think we're on the road a couple times. But please come on back, man. We'll all get together, fucking laugh our troubles away. That is it for Hollywood Babylon this week. I'm Kevin Smith.
I'm Ralph Garman.
Babble the fuck off. Good night, everybody.
Thank you, guys.